at the top, especially when you're always putting on an act. There's a lot of brilliance in him, and people admire him for it. And when he spoke to you, he had a way of making you feel like you were the most important thing in his life. But the man behind the curtain, like, you know, any great Wizard of Oz, will, reveals that this is a man that's extremely haunted by a lot of skeletons from his past.
Good afternoon. I have just been to see Her Majesty the Queen, who has invited me to form a government. And I have accepted.
Boris Johnson is now Prime Minister, a world leader. But he has problems to contend with.
I just want to restore trust in our democracy. And we're going to fulfill the repeated promises of Parliament to the people and come out of the EU on October the 31st. No ifs or buts. This government will work flat out to give this country the leadership it deserves. And that work begins now. Thank you very much.
I remember going in with Carrie on the day he went into number 10. I was with her as we stood outside the door, clapping him in as he arrived. There'd been no previous Prime Minister who hadn't come into number 10 with his wife. So to actually come into number 10 with a girlfriend was breaking... it was totally new ground. So it was a concern as to whether that would work against him. But he was determined when he arrived in number 10 he would be able to take control.
Within hours of coming to power, in a bold move, Boris forces out an unprecedented number of the cabinet. Dispensing with rivals and critics, he quickly assembles loyalists and Brexiteers, even making space for the man who betrayed him, Michael Gove.
Right. Morning, everybody, and it is wonderful to see this new team assembled here, respecting, I think, the depth and breadth of talent in our extraordinary party.
Boris chooses Matt Hancock for Health Secretary.
Cabinet with Boris was completely different to cabinet with Theresa May, as you can imagine. And I think in his first cabinet, he started by saying, right, we've got an hour, so let's try to wrap this one up.
Fellow Etonian Jacob Rees-Mogg becomes his new leader of the House of Commons.
I've nailed my colours very firmly to the Boris Johnson mast, and I'm very glad that I've done so. I think it was the right thing to do, and he is an exceptional leader.
He promotes Gavin Williamson to Secretary for Education.
He was asking me, who do you make Chancellor? And I said to him, make the person Chancellor who ideally you've got a good relationship with, who's ideally a friend. And he was like, well, I don't have that many friends in politics.
Yeah, he told me he wanted to have me in his team. As Chancellor, I was living in Downing Street, and it meant that you'd see more of each other, especially in informal settings. You'd literally bump into each other, especially at weekends. I remember my daughter, at the time she would have been about 10. One Saturday morning, she took the dog out into the garden, and comes back up and very sort of matter-of-factly then said, oh, Dad, I just ran into Boris in the garden. He was in his boxers again. and he was with Dylan, his dog, and he said, you're around later today, and he wants to see you about 12. What do you want me to tell him? And so, you know, that was what life was like in Downing Street.
In amongst the Brexiteers, Boris also appoints his younger brother, Joe, a staunch Remainer.
Look, I mean, in the campaign, there were undoubtedly promises made that have shown to be undeliverable.
Is that an elegant way of saying that we were lied to?
Well, look, it was a false prospectus. It was a fantasy set of promises that have been shown up for what they were.
And with just 3 months to deliver Brexit, there's one thing standing in his way. Parliament.
It was a terrible time. There seemed to be a sort of rigor mortis had taken over in Westminster. We're going round and round in circles. And British politics was kind of locked in a debilitating limbo.
We had defeated the government 40 times on various aspects of Brexit.
Order. Statement, the Prime Minister. Yeah.
Mr. Speaker, with permission, I shall make a statement on the mission of this new Conservative government. The
parliamentary system plays into this Oxford Union nonsense, which is about you just throw abuse around, you try to belittle or your opponent, you try to mock them.
Mr. Speaker, if the Prime Minister continues to pursue a reckless no deal, does he accept that he would be directly flouting the expressed will of this Parliament?
He speaks about trust in our democracy, Mr. Speaker, and I have to say, a most extraordinary thing has just happened today. Did anybody notice what happened today? Did anybody notice the terrible metamorphosis that took place, like the final scene of Invasion of the Body Snatchers? At last, this long-standing Eurosceptic, the Right Honourable Gentleman, has been captured. He has been jugulated. He has been reprogrammed by his honourable friends. He has been turned now into a Remainer. He has turned Labour into the party.
I would like to look inside Boris Johnson's head and find what's there, because I think there is a very intelligent, calculating individual there who lives in a persona which is the opposite.
By Press TV, who repeatedly sides with the mullahs of Tehran rather than our friends in the United States over what is happening in the Persian Gulf. How incredible that we should even think of entrusting that gentleman with the stewardship of this country's security.
Three in Blackburn.
Yeah. Try to take Scotland. Try to take the United Kingdom out of the European Union on a no-deal basis. Parliament will stop this madness in its tracks.
Parliament was terrible. I mean, there's no other word to describe it. They were sabotaging any negotiations with Europe if they could. Everything was a fight. I think it made him realise that getting Brexit through was going to be a very, very difficult battle. So something had to give.
Boris begins hatching his own plan for dealing with Parliament. But it's not the only problem he's contending with. He's negotiating a divorce from Marina, his second wife, and the mother of 4 of his children. And a scandal from his past is about to break.
Well, that's his missus. His wife, yeah.
His wife,
yeah.
July 2018. Boris's second wife, Marina, is moving out. It follows the revelation of an affair with his colleague, Carrie Simmons. This isn't the first time Boris has been unfaithful. His relationship with women is a complex one, beginning with his first serious girlfriend when he was a student.
I first met his beautiful and delightful girlfriend, Allegra Mostyneau. She'd been on the cover of the Tatler magazine, photographed by David Bailey. Allegra said to me, "Will you meet my boyfriend? He wants to get into journalism." I thought he was very bright, very energetic, not arrogant, very good company, actually. I went to the wedding. It was beautifully done. Allegra wanted Boris to wear a ring, and Boris didn't want to. And he managed to lose the ring within about 2 hours of their getting married.
Boris was 23 when he married Allegra. Like his parents before him, the pair met at university.
Yes, he did tell Allegra that she reminded him of his mother. I mean, that's obviously a very serious compliment. I think he really wanted the approval of liberal-minded, particularly women, and was pained if they thought he was a monster. For example, he was very, very stricken when his first marriage broke down. He'd been very inconsiderate in his behaviour, but he still didn't want it to break down. He's very needy, actually. He doesn't like being alone, and he hasn't very often been alone. He can't bear it.
12 days after his divorce from Allegra is finalised, Boris marries Marina, who is 8 months pregnant.
So I think she was undoubtedly a stabilising influence. She was very, very good at telling him when his behaviour was intolerable or when what he was doing was intolerable. I mean, she chucked him out from time to time, but she didn't sort of hurl him into outer space. He sort of moved to a room down the road or something, or go and stay with friends. So there was a way back on several occasions.
7 years into his marriage, and just after the birth of his fourth child, Boris becomes editor of the Spectator magazine and starts a relationship with a colleague.
He was a very loyal person, and I think that means a lot in a relationship. There was this solid foundation of trust, and it got to the point where I felt I could tell Boris almost anything, which was very nice, because that doesn't often happen. You really felt like he was protecting you. He liked to see himself as a sort of knight from Camelot, which wasn't always true, but it was nice that he wanted to see himself that way. But I noticed that he was somebody who doesn't like arguments, because arguing means that the other person might dislike him. And whenever I used to get angry, I could see him looking terrified. So everything would sort of be bottled up, and I wouldn't say it would fester, but it wasn't that healthy. And he sort of lacked moral courage. And that was why he would tell lies. So he'd promise people things that you knew that he never meant to keep. And it wasn't because he wanted to hurt them or disappoint them. He just wanted to please them at that given moment. And then he'd think, oh, my God, how am I going to get out of it?
Summer 2019. Boris came to power promising that he would get Brexit done. But he needs his plan to be approved by Parliament. And so far, they have blocked him.
Lack of self-confidence is never something that I'd imagine would have been written in any of Boris's school reports. He believes in himself in a way that, I've never really seen in anyone else. And it's that confidence, it's that bravado, it's that belief that carries him so well. You know, he's willing to take risks. He's willing to break the mould because Boris, I believe, always believes in Boris.
1 month into his premiership, and Boris decides to do something extraordinary. Shut Parliament down. According to an old British law, Parliament can be put into recess if it's at the end of a parliamentary session, in a process called prorogation.
That was like declaring war on Parliament. I mean, I don't think it's ever been done before, not in these circumstances. I mean, you prorogue Parliament at the end of its parliamentary time, but not to do it like that.
Boris's plan is that during this recess, with Parliament unable to challenge him, he will be able to push through Brexit however he wishes. But to prorogue Parliament, he first needs permission from Her Majesty the Queen. Whilst Boris stays in Westminster, he sends his ally, Jacob Rees-Mogg, on a secret mission to Balmoral. But before Rees-Mogg has taken off, news of his mission has spread.
The former Prime Minister, Sir John Major, has said he would go to court to stop Parliament being suspended over Brexit.
People feel like it would be extremely undemocratic to suspend MPs from sitting to avoid them from expressing a view that's opposing to the Prime Minister.
The last time this was done, wasn't there a civil war?
I'm thinking this is not quite as secret as was intended. As soon as I get to Heathrow, people start asking me for selfies. We were meant to be going as incognito as possible. As we're getting off the plane, we are on a telephone call for a cabinet meeting to approve the prorogation, which was meant to be done later in a more calm sense, but it was done literally as we were walking off the plane. Then we have this wonderful trip to Balmoral in a charabanc, this kind descent by the royal household, with the late Queen's hairdresser, who is absolutely brilliant. So we had a very jolly journey with him telling the stories. And then we're taken in to see the Queen, joined by one of her corgis, a very elderly and I think deaf corgi. And Her Majesty thought it was not suitable for the corgi to remain. So the Queen was trying to shuffle out this deaf corgi that was very reluctant to go. And we got down to the business of the prorogation.
Boris Johnson has successfully sought to suspend Parliament in a bid to prevent MPs from thwarting Brexit, a development which only 4 days ago was described by Downing Street as entirely false.
Today, the Prime Minister basically said, let's take Parliament out of the equation so we can, you know, get on with this thing.
He's acting like some kind of tin pot dictator. And if MPs don't stop it, then it is no exaggeration, it is not hyperbole to say this is the day any semblance of UK parliamentary democracy absolutely dies.
Boris Johnson wants to write himself into history, but the methods he'll pursue to do that could make or break him too.
Within hours, the public take to the streets, accusing Boris of undermining democracy.
People that might say this is an undemocratic move.
Say they wouldn't know what they were talking about. It's normal functioning of our constitution.
It was this sort of arrogant confidence of these people that sort of get away with things.
Demonstrations are taking place everywhere because people are angered and outraged at what is happening. Think on, Boris. It's not on. It's not happening.
While protests continue in London, Boris heads north to face the public.
Thank you very much, Jake. Well, good morning, everybody. It's great to be here in Rotherham, in the Magna Centre, which is, of course, the plural of magnum, which, as everybody knows, is the Latin for ice cream.
Why are you not with them in Parliament sorting out the mess that you have created?
Would you mind? I'm very happy. I'm very happy to see.
Why don't you sort it out, Boris? Why don't you sort it out?
Please leave my town.
I will very soon.
You should be in Brussels negotiating.
Yes, we have been negotiating.
You are not. You are in Morley in Leeds.
While Boris is being accosted in Leeds, news breaks closer to home.
Hello, Mr. Johnson.
His own brother has quit the cabinet.
Can you tell us when you're planning to resign?
I haven't got any further comment to say, other than it's been an honour to be MP for Orpington and a minister under three governments. But it's time to move on, and I've got to get to work.
The party?
Sorry, I beg your pardon.
Are you completely at odds with your brother, Mr. Johnson?
Right. See you, folks.
How can I, or any rational voter, trust Boris to act in the national interest if his own brother can't?
I'm sure you've seen in the news Joe Johnson resigned as an MP and minister, saying he was torn between family loyalty and the national interest.
I've already made some comments. Thank you very much.
I remember speaking to Boris on the day Joe resigned, and I often thought the extraordinary thing is that Joe did that without telling Boris, because he's, you know, I spoke to him and I said, you know, what does it mean? He said, well, I don't know. He didn't even tell me. I think he was pretty shaken by it.
Mr. Johnson, you said you would unite our country. If your own brother doesn't trust you to act in the national interest, why should all of we?
Well, Joe doesn't agree with me about the European Union because it's an issue that obviously divides families and divides everybody. But I think what Joe would agree is that we need to get on and sort this thing out.
If your own brother has lost faith in your plan, surely you'll have to be the next member of the Johnson family to resign.
Well, you're right. Oh, that's right. I'm so sorry. Okay, I think that is a signal for me actively to wind up. Thank you.
It's quite hurtful, really. I mean, it's quite painful to know that even your own brother is not supporting you. And he was very isolated in this battle. Now, I was never worried about him. I mean, he's very robust, but you could tell it was taking a toll. I mean, everything in every direction was difficult.
While he may have dealt with Parliament for now, this is just one of a number of plates he has spinning. In his private life, he is still negotiating a divorce from his wife, Marina. And the press is delving into a previous relationship when Boris was mayor.
I established a source who had a huge hard drive of emails between this young, spunky American graduate by the name of Jennifer R. Currie and then occupant of City Hall, Boris Johnson. You know, our interest in the story, you know, wasn't prurient. It wasn't just about whether they were an item sexually. I mean, it was, did this or did it not involve kind of improper conduct for a person in elected office? And his status as mayor was at the heart of their relationship and what he stood to offer her.
Thank you very much, everybody, for coming along today. I hope you're having a productive session. And Jennifer's now going to instruct. We've now got to go over and talk to California. Is that right? I'm ready to hang. I'm ready to hang out. Yeah, I am.
Yeah, look at that. Boris is hanging out.
He's not the womanizer people think he is. They think because he's got all these women and all these escapades, really, it's an emotional insecurity, this man. Firm there, knows London very well as well. Now, that doesn't mean that he didn't have, you know, affairs or flings with other people. I did. So, I mean, I was still dating. I was 26.
Export of London. In LA, we have
Boris was mayor of London when he first met Jennifer, a rising tech star. And she asked him to speak at her business's event.
Yeah, he was like, Jennifer, I'm going to lay this all out on the table. I want to date you. I said, oh, no, see, I'm way too much for you. I'm high maintenance. And he was like, what? Like handbags and shit. You know, and he had like a little laugh. And I thought, no, I'm far too much work. This is going to be a disaster. And he was like,
And he starts laughing. He's like, I like you. I like you a lot. A lot, a lot. And he's like, and I can't stop thinking about you. One of the things I noticed, whether it was pressure, stress, paranoia, there just seemed to be times when he became very emotionally needy. And that was when you saw a lot of recklessness and kind of toxic behavior. You know, this, I don't know, maybe the obsession with women, or, you know, one of his friends from childhood called it mommy issues when he was explaining to me his emotional need to be validated by women, and how much that was a big part of who he was. It made me concerned with how close one could get to this man without getting burned. I started to hear rumors of how he had had an affair with another woman and had a child with her outside of his marriage. And he looks at me and he says something like, now, Jennifer, I like you a lot, and I love my family, and I love my children. He's like, but you must promise me one thing. He's like, you mustn't read the news. You mustn't read them. Promise me you won't. And I said, well, a girl's gotta ask, and I will always be honest with you, always, but you must never read the paper. You know, you have questions, you come to me and me alone. He said to me one time, now, Jennifer, I wanna be very clear, all jokes aside, no bullshit. Very seriously, he's like, I care about you a lot, and I never, ever wanna hurt you.
September 2019, and Boris is in New York, meeting world leaders for a climate summit at the United Nations. He is just 2 months into his premiership, which has been continuously engulfed in controversy. But things are about to get worse. The Arcuri story is breaking.
More scrutiny for the Prime Minister over links to a US businesswoman. Now the police watchdog is involved.
I've got to ask you about the allegations against the Prime Minister today. Have you sought reassurances that this was not a relationship that needed to be declared?
She's one of the most talked about women at the heart of a political scandal involving sex, money, and foreign trips.
Did you misuse public funds?
Everything that I did was done in complete conformity with the rules.
What was the nature of your relationship with Jennifer Arcuri? Were you friends or was it something else?
I worked incredibly hard as Mayor of London to promote our city, and
are you still
very
in
happy
touch with
the
her?
Result.
I was very upset about the way they portrayed me in the press. I left that man years ago. I was happily moved on.
What was your relationship with Jennifer Arcuri, Prime Minister? Do you have an interest to declare?
It was disgusting the way we were treated. You know, just the way jumping out of trees, following us in the car. I had to lay in the back seat not to be harassed. They stand outside my daughter's school on school runs, take pictures across the street. I mean, it was just so intrusive.
With press interest growing and unsure how to respond, Jennifer tries to reach out to Boris for help.
I just thought, okay, let's be logical. I'll just send him a text. You know, we should probably talk. And that's when I noticed I had been blocked. And I thought that was very strange. He doesn't do things like that. That's not who he is. And then I got through and he said, yes, hello. And I said, what's going on? Why did you block me? And the phone was taken. You know, and then you hear this, what you want? Who are you talking to? And somebody clearly mocking me, pretending to be some Chinese tourist. Hello? You know, just really obnoxious. There's no reason why two adults couldn't speak, especially when the stakes are this high. You know, it uprooted everything in my family. And to not be able to speak to him about that, what a wimp. What a spineless coward. And I hate saying that because I cared a great deal about the man and I know he cared about me, but that's cowardice. Call it what it is. And women, if men do that to you, that is a get the hell out of here now kind of trait.
As the story continues making waves, just 2 days later, Boris is again under scrutiny. This time, over prorogation. Boris maintains his actions were legitimate, and any challenge is a move to undermine Brexit. But a private citizen, Gina Miller, is taking him to the Supreme Court to question whether he acted lawfully.
Respect democracy, Miller! Respect
the House of Soros in fucking 400,000!
400,000! To the gallows!
Every day, Boris Johnson were telling people like this that I was stealing their Brexit, that I was going against the will of the people, against their will. And he was fueling the anger that they were feeling towards me. It was unbelievable. This is one of the biggest constitutional cases for 200 years. To take on a government, to ask the courts, can Parliament, our entire Parliament, be closed down and bypassed? Can a Prime Minister do this? Is he basically betraying our democracy and our parliamentary sovereignty?
All rise.
The Supreme Court will make an historic judgment later on Boris Johnson's suspension of Parliament.
Over 30 million people watched the proceedings online.
This judgment is the unanimous judgment of all 11 justices. The court is bound to conclude, therefore, that the decision to advise Her Majesty to prorogue Parliament was unlawful.
The ruling today speaks volumes. This Prime Minister must open the doors of Parliament tomorrow.
It was all a big game. You've got somebody in Boris who really doesn't care of the consequences of what he does. It's always about winning and being in power.
Boris is in New York with Donald Trump when the verdict comes through.
Well, thank you very much, everyone. It's great to be with my friend Boris Johnson. Just got a position that he's having a very easy time with. It's much easier than he thought. I just said, is it tougher or easier? He said, well, it's, I guess, what he expected. I think it's pretty much what you expected.
It is. Mr. Johnson, some of your critics are saying that you should resign because you misled the Queen with regard to shutting Parliament down. How do you respond to that?
Well, as I said earlier on, thank you very much. Well, as I said earlier on, let's be absolutely clear. We respect the judiciary in our country. We respect the court. I disagree profoundly with what they had to say.
Mr. President, what was your reaction when you heard the UK Supreme Court decision? What was your reaction?
I had no reaction. I just asked Boris, and, you know, to him it's another day in the office. He's a professional. It's just another day in the office.
Yeah, well, it's tomorrow is another day in Parliament. That's what he said. We're full of respect, as I say, for the justices of our Supreme Court, but we're gonna respect what the court had to say, but we're gonna get on and deliver Brexit. I think that's what the British people want.
In other words, he's been very nice to the court, please. Okay.
He has
total respect for the court. Yeah, Jim.
Mr. President, on a separate subject, can you explain why...
What you've got in Boris Johnson and Donald Trump is you had two individuals who are playing from exactly the same script, which was to take their country to a much more autocratic state where they're unanswerable to the people of the country, and where they're through division, they were gaining power.
Now Boris must return to Parliament to face the music.
Why does he think he can treat the Queen and country with such utter contempt?
Even my five-year-old knows that if you do something wrong, you have to say sorry.
After yesterday's ruling, Mr. Speaker, the Prime Minister should have done the honourable thing and resigned.
A lot of people in Parliament were saying, my goodness, the Prime Minister has lost a case. This is catastrophic, this is devastating. And I said, no, it probably isn't.
It is absolutely no disrespect to the judiciary to say I think the court was wrong to pronounce on what is essentially a political question at a time.
Whilst Boris strategises his next move to push Brexit through, the questions keep coming.
Some people don't support your approach. Even your own brother Joe walked out of your government and he said he'd stand down as an MP just 6 weeks after agreeing to stick by you. That must have been really hard for you.
Yes, but we're a very tight-knit, close-knit family, and there may be people who disagree with that.
Rachel talked about your language, though, and she said that my brother using words like should be hung, drawn, quartered, tarred and feathered. I think it's highly reprehensible. Did you talk to her about that after she said that to you?
Well, look, I don't want to go into conversations between members of my family, which is,
what
I say, is a very loving
and
tight-knit family.
Were you having an affair with Jennifer Akuri?
Look, I've said what I've had to say about that matter.
I wouldn't ask on
the question you asked, I never comment on that kind of thing.
You want to believe that your friend can be a great leader, and you want to believe that he can handle the pressure. But if he can't even handle the confrontation of his own personal life, the man can't clean up his own laundry, there's no way he's going to do it for the country.
Everything is done with complete propriety. And I may say, I think it is interesting.
I don't want to talk about your private life. It's the issue about whether you misuse public money. That's why I'm asking.
Well, I can certainly say there was absolutely no, there was no question of that at all.
Our allegation's going to ruin this whole thing.
Boris needs to get Brexit done and cement his place in Parliament. To do that, he needs a clear majority over the opposition. So he makes a decision. He will announce an election.
It was blazingly obvious that Boris was just going to keep going, you know, keep driving forward relentlessly until he got Brexit done. He had to, right? If he gave up, he would have been the shortest term Prime Minister then in history.
But having faced a wave of political and personal scandals, and just 3 months into his premiership, it's the biggest gamble of his career to date.
Are you ready for the contest ahead? Are you pumped up? Let's go out there and win! Win that election! Win for Labour! And get a Labour government!
The thing I think that I noticed was that having been released finally from that dreadful, suffocating cockpit called Westminster for him, he was back in the one place that you want him. You want him on the public stage.
He's very good with people. He likes interacting with people and makes them feel good. And that's true, I think, whether he's campaigning politically or he's in a social setting. He's the kind of person you'd sort of want to be around if you want to have a good time and have some fun conversation.
Yeah, you've definitely got our vote. We do not like government.
It's time to bring our divided country together.
It was obviously a very pressurised time. But I don't think he'd be particularly worrying his head about details of anything, actually. And I remember I phoned him up and he said, I'm going to be working, my hand is going to be firmly tied to the oar. I will be pulling the boat along. OK. So I said, well, if your hand is tied to one oar, the boat will be going in circles. And he said, good point. And he then went off in ancient Greek about the effect of a boat going in circles, which I didn't understand at all.
Oh, how are you? Nice to see you. Thanks. Oops, so sorry. Thanks for coming.
You've been going for 13 hours.
Oh, nothing. Nothing. We're
exhausted.
Hard as nails. Steel springs, that's what we are.
How do you keep your energy up? 13-hour day.
I think it's genetic. I have a lot of energy.
Haribos by the bunchload?
No, I don't. I sometimes succumb to flapjacks.
He set out the general narrative of what he wanted, and his style, he would just keep on saying, the whole issue is get Brexit done. And I challenged him and said, well, you're not going to get Brexit done. It's not all going to be over on polling day. You know that. And he said, we're going to get Brexit done. We're going to get Brexit done. I mean, at one level, it's clever, but at the other level, it's totally irresponsible. He would always try to portray me as some kind of evil force within our society, which was then parroted by the papers. Sunday afternoon, I sat down and I read the Daily Mail. Page after page about what an evil person Jeremy Corbyn was. Page after page, this man grows his own vegetables, this man keeps a cat, this man, etc., etc. So I got to the end of it, I put the paper down, looked at the cat, and I thought, that Corbyn, God, he's an evil sod. It was just the demonization of me, it was unbelievable.
A very good evening. For the fourth time in the space of 5 years, the future of the United Kingdom is uncertain. And this time, with politics in deadlock and Brexit unresolved, the stakes are higher than ever. This is a Conservative gain from Labour. This is in Greater Manchester.
Looking at a seat like that, going from red to blue, that's astonishing.
Well, I never thought in all this time that I'd see Wrexham, of all places, turning Conservative.
Boris Johnson, who just a year ago was on the back benches, may just have redrawn the map.
Boris Johnson has this extraordinary connection with voters. People like Boris's approach to life. They like his ebullience, the fun of politics, the interest of it.
We have another Conservative game.
The Conservatives taking real chunks out of the Labour heartland.
Hello, how are you?
Bishop Auckland has been Labour since 1935. Well, look, it's gone Conservative.
Johnson, Alexander Boris de Pfeffel, commonly known as Boris Johnson, the Conservative Party candidate, 25,000.
Over the past decade, I've seen politicians who have not paid the penalty for getting things wrong, not paid a political penalty. One was Donald Trump and Boris Johnson. You know, I mean, people knew he was a bit of a chancer, but for a while it didn't seem to matter. The character overcame that.
It is 6:13 in the morning. The Conservatives have won the general election with a hefty majority of 80 seats. That is our current calculation. The last time the Tories had a majority, anything like this, was when Margaret Thatcher was re-elected in 1987.
Thanks very much. Thanks for coming. I really appreciate it. Thanks very much.
Hold there a second.
Thank you. Thanks for coming. Thanks for coming.
Oh, sorry. My little dog has come to meet you.
Come on, what's the name of your Teasel?
Teasel.
Hello. How are you? Maybe Teasel. Here we go.
But it has been a historic victory for a man who's wanted the job so long. He's an extremely divisive and controversial figure, but he's also made a career of doing things that people have told him were impossible. He was told it would be impossible to turn London blue, and then he won the mayoralty twice. Then he was, of course, told, oh, you can't win the EU referendum. And then, as it's Brexit's main cheerleader, he did. And then told, you can never turn places like Bishop Auckland or Darlington or Warrington blue. And then look at what has happened tonight.
The election result was absolutely wonderful. There was just this real sense that we had a proper mandate. This wasn't just a mandate from the Conservative Party, this was a mandate from the people.
He won the leadership because he wanted to be Prime Minister. He won the election because he wanted to prove he could. And after that, I'm not sure what he really wanted to do.
It was incredibly exciting. There wasn't a cloud on the political horizon. You know, we had a big majority, we could get Brexit done. We had 5 years to sort out all sorts of problems. It was going to be great. Then it wasn't.
Boris is back tomorrow night. New year means new problems. From the pandemic to Partygate, the series concludes at 9, and you can stream the whole series right now. Right, bit of light relief next. She's single, she's 70, and she's searching for some naked attraction.